God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
Amen. It's good to be here worshiping today as we gather at the Lord's table. So a reminder for people that are worshiping at home that you can grab your communion supplies and join us here as we extend the table from this place into your home or wherever you might be watching. Just share a few announcements with you today. Reminder again about the Lavender Potluck that's coming up on the 28th of the month. There's a sign-up sheet over here in the fellowship hall and information about that. So these are all around the end of the month and then beginning of next month. So the 31st is our Sizzling Summer Sale Move Day. Which means that we need some people that have, you know, good sturdy backs and, you know, can lift a few things and help bring items down, many that are already boxed and kind of ready to go, but they need to be brought down from storage to the church as the group kind of gets ready for the sale. So that's a Wednesday. What time again, Bobby? Was it 9 o'clock? Okay. Yeah, so, check your calendars, kind of spread the word. We could use some help on the 31st for moving items down for the Sizzling Summer Sale. And I want to make sure that everybody marks the 4th of September, which is Labor Day weekend. Mark that on your calendar. That is our send-off day for Diane Zimmer. Her last day of playing will be the 28th of August, and then she's packing up and getting ready to move. I think it's the 7th of September she's moving, but she'll be here on the 4th, not playing, but just so that we can, give her hugs and send her off. If you're going to be gone or traveling that weekend and you want to send a card or something to her or send it to the church so we can collect them and give them to her, either way, just kind of be mindful of that. It's so sad to see her taken off, but we want to send her off in prayer and in love. So be ready. All right, I invite you to rise in body or in spirit and join in our call to worship. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come?
Our help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth.
The Lord is the one who will not let your foot be moved.
The God who keeps us will not slumber.
God neither slumbers nor sleeps.
The Lord is our keeper.
The Lord is the shade at our right hand.
The sun shall not strike us by day, nor the moon by night.
The Lord will keep us from all evil.
God is the keeper of our lives.
The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in.
From this time on and forevermore. Thanks be to God.
Well, while you're standing, please join us in our first song. It's As We Gather.
As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, may we glorify your name. Knowing well that as our hearts begin to worship, we'll be blessed because we came. We'll be blessed because we came. As we gather, may your spirit work within us. As we gather, we'll be blessed because we came.
In Matthew 22, verses 37 through 40, our Lord Jesus said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." What do we tell ourselves when we fall short of these commands? Do we justify our actions, avoid facing them, or simply ignore them? We worship a righteous God who is also loving and merciful. So let us approach him with reverence and contrition and confess our sins first silently and personally. And then join with me in the prayer of confession printed on the screen and in your bulletin. Let us pray. and now together. Heavenly Father, we confess that we do not live up to your holy name. We are often more ready to resent than to forgive, more ready to manipulate than to serve, more ready to hate than to love, more ready to keep our distance than to welcome or help. At the root of this behavior is fear and doubt. We do not love one another as we should because we do not believe that you love us as you do. Forgive us our cold unbelief and cowering fear, and make more vivid to us the meaning and depth of your love at the cross. Show us what it cost you to give up your Son, that we might lose our fear and truly become your sons and daughters. We ask this in the name of Jesus, our righteousness. Amen. Indeed, we are free to love the Lord our God with all our heart and with all our soul and with all our mind. And we are free to love our neighbors as ourselves. And we can do this because God loves us so much that he didn't even spare his own son's life in order to offer us salvation. So embrace this truth and believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Please greet one another with the peace of Christ and extend by prayer the peace of Christ to those within our church family. Peace be with you. Our first scripture reading today comes from Genesis 15, verses 1 through 6. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own issue shall be your heir. He brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to count them. Then he said to him, so shall your descendants be. And he believed the Lord. And the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now with the children's message, Pastor Matt will lead us with the time for young disciples.
So the scripture lesson we're going to look at today has to do with being ready. And Jesus talks about not worrying, and then he also talks about being ready. And that being ready part can make us maybe a little bit anxious. I'm going to talk more about that in the sermon. But for our young people, I have an exercise that you can try. Because what I want to talk about in terms of being ready for when Jesus comes is just getting our hearts in a place of gratitude, being thankful. I'll tell you a little story. We had a member in church back in Iowa City who told me that during the sermons, he would write down a word that I said and go through the alphabet. So if I said Abram, for instance, he would write down Abram. So if he heard a word that began with A, he'd write that down. Then he'd go for B, and he'd wait, and he'd listen. And if I said before, he'd write down before, and he'd work his way through the alphabet. And he told me about this, and afterwards, I would go up and ask him, how far did you get today? You know, to see. And there were times when I would purposely put things in my sermon, because like a Q, you know, for instance, I would put a Q word in there just to see if he caught it and, you know, if he made it all the way through the alphabet. So here's an exercise that that you can do and our kids can do is go through your day and look for things that you're thankful for. When you see them, go through the alphabet. So maybe you get up for breakfast and you have a slice of apple with your breakfast. That's your first thing, apple, something you're thankful for. And, you know, and then work your way on down through the alphabet and see how far you can get each day. And then when you're done with your day, reflect back on all the things that you are grateful for. And I think if we do that, we'll be ready. And we won't have to worry about being ready. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you for all the things that you give us. Help us to look at our world and make that list, make it grow each day, all the things that we are grateful for that you give us. In your name we pray, amen. So our gospel lesson this morning is found in Luke. We're turning to chapter 12, verses 32 through 40. Here Jesus is speaking. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that do not wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet, so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour. This is the word of the Lord. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, may you open your word to us to fill our hearts with peace, the knowledge of your truth. Grant that the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts would be holy and acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Getting ready for a trip. We get the anxiety over getting ready for, you know, going away for a night or so. And even in the days preceding, you're starting to think about the things that you need to pack and kind of, you know, make sure that you have set aside. Becca and I are going for just a night over to Victoria or Vancouver Island tomorrow morning on the ferry. We've never driven on the ferry, so it's our first time driving onto the ferry. We're going to stay over to celebrate our 30th wedding anniversary, which is actually at the end of the month. And already I'm thinking about the things that I need to pack, and it's just for, you know, it's just for one night. You know, it's not like it's a big deal, but I'm thinking through in my head. I found myself waking up last night like, oh, well, what about this? Or, you know, to make sure I have, bring the camera with me and bring the charger and all these kinds of things going through my head. And I want you to think about some of that anxiety that you might get about being prepared as we take a look at this passage. The readings from Luke that we've been looking at the last few weeks are part of a sermon that Jesus preached to his disciples along with a great crowd that had followed him, who had come to hear him. And it's not exactly the same, yet the message in Luke has many parallels to the Sermon on the Mount. It's the equivalent, if you will, the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew, the more famous of the two, I would say. So take these verses that precede today's reading that we kind of skipped over from last week and consider this. Jesus said to his disciples, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat, or about your body, what you will wear. For life is more than food, and the body more than clothing. Consider the ravens. They neither sow nor reap. They have neither storehouse nor barn, and yet God feeds them. Of how much more value are you than the birds? And can any of you, by worrying, add a single hour to your span of life? If then you are not able to do so small a thing as that, why do you worry about the rest? Consider the lilies, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, how much more will he clothe you, you of little faith? Do not keep striving for what you are to eat and what you are to drink, and do not keep worrying. For it is the nations of the world that strive after all these things, and your Father knows that you need them. Instead, strive for his kingdom, and these things will be given to you as well." It is against that backdrop that we enter into today's lesson, a lesson that has paradox in its messages. "Do not be afraid, little flock," Jesus says, "for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." What a comforting thought. "But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." Have you ever been in bed and heard a noise in the middle of the night? That's what it feels like when I see that part about, you know, the unexpected hour. What vivid and terrifying imagery of a thief breaking into your house. It raises questions, really. Are we supposed to take comfort in this passage? Are we supposed to take cover? What about all this being ready business? What does it look like to be ready? Our church in Spokane, there was a sign up in the media booth that said, "Look busy, Jesus is coming," right? You know, "Jesus is coming, look busy." Just thinking about it, you know, every time I saw that sign, just made me a little bit anxious, like, whoa, am I busy enough right now? Just thinking about it makes my heart skip a beat. And not to mention what Jesus says in his passage here about selling possessions and giving alms. How will I know if I'm giving enough, right? What if my treasure in heaven is not big enough for me to retire there? We talked about this in Bible study this week. We're talking about the idea of, you know, building treasure in heaven. On one hand, it sounds wonderful that the things that we do here provide a storehouse on the other side. And yet we quickly get into the mindset of the world and we wonder, well, how much do we need? With the idea being, well, if I've got enough there, then maybe I can kind of relax a little bit, like, you know, you might do with retirement or something. How much is enough? At this point, maybe we should just step back Step back and consider the lilies and the ravens, how God provides for them. They simply do what ravens and lilies do, and God blesses them. We could learn a lot from the ravens and the lilies. If God is pleased with ravens and lilies doing what God created them to do, how much more is God pleased with us when we, Jesus' disciples, are doing what Jesus or God created us to do? To trust in God as Abram did in the promise that we saw in the Old Testament passage. To be generous as God is generous with us, or demonstrated by Jesus who offers his life at the Lord's table, which we're gathering at today. To care for others, and in so doing, build a store of treasure in heaven. What if being ready is not about being busy, but about practicing discipleship, simply being what God has created us to be. God hasn't created us to strive after material things. God hasn't created us to strive for power. God has created us to be a partner in the ministry of Jesus Christ in this world, sharing our possessions, being generous with what God has given us, working for peace and reconciliation in our relationships and in our world, practicing forgiveness. So poignant as it came out in the prayer of confession, how hard it is sometimes, how stingy we are in forgiving others. Reaching out to the poor and the marginalized, praying for the needs of the world, giving toward God's work in the world, and being in Christian study and fellowship with one another. What if simply being what God has created us to be, as disciples of Christ, would be enough? So what might seem scary is really an invitation, in fact, to join in the joy of God's kingdom. For it's God's good pleasure to give us the kingdom and for us to bless the world by sharing the kingdom with others. And it's in sharing with others that we experience the true joy of being in the kingdom. Think about that for a moment. Something that you might have done, felt inspired to do, to reach out and to help someone else. I was listening to a podcaster talking about, the Secret Santa. You ever do a Secret Santa, like where you worked or with family members? You have somebody that you're going to give a gift to, and you give it anonymously, and then later on you might share, who your Secret Santa was. Well, in the podcast, we were doing a little dive into the origin of the Secret Santa story, and I can't remember the gentleman's name, but it began with a man who, where he worked, he would go around, and I presume he must have been maybe the owner of the company. He would go around, and he would just give out $100 bills to people, kind of sort of seemingly randomly. And it's said that over the course of his lifetime, he gave out somewhere in the neighborhood of $1.5 million. It began when he was young. He grew up in a poor family. He was destitute. He was hungry. And he went into a diner to get some food. He didn't have any money. He ate a big meal. And then when it came time to pay the check, he pretended to be looking for his wallet, which he couldn't find because he didn't have. And as he's kind of starting to make a show about this, the server comes up to him and taps him on the shoulder and says, "Sir, I believe you dropped this." And he handed him a $20 bill. He paid for his food, and he left. And then it dawned on him what had happened. And that inspired him that as he grew in his own wealth, as he began to kind of get a life for himself, it inspired him to share with others. And he went back later, I don't know how long later, he went back and found that server and repaid him. Of course, the server said, no, you don't have to do that. It's sharing with others that we experience the joy of the kingdom. And consider this in what Jesus says about the nature of God and what delights God in these two verses. Do not be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It is God's good pleasure that we should rejoice and be in his kingdom and share it. And verse 37, blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. What kind of master serves his slaves? And this is God's outrageous generosity, that when God finds us ready, having served others, that God serves us as we experience when we come to the Lord's table and we receive this precious gift from Christ. This same God blessed the world long ago through a covenant that God made with Abram. And Abram, through no effort of his own, was given an incredible promise that despite the advanced age of he and his wife, that they would have a son. Abram and his wife would become parents of a great nation whose offspring would be too great to count. They were blessed, given a share of God's kingdom, that they would in turn be a blessing for others. Jesus' message might seem paradoxical, but at its heart it's an assurance of God's love and generosity toward us, and that we can be ready and rest easy by doing what Jesus has called us to do, to trust that it's God's pleasure to give us the kingdom, and that we can be free from materialism, free to love, and to share God's good pleasure with the world. Let us pray. Lord, inspire us to be grateful, to share, and to experience the vast wonder of your kingdom and all its joy. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you.
invite you to remain standing as we prepare to come to the Lord's table in a moment. Let us share our faith and affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Words that begin with the letter Q. How about qualified? It's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Lisa Searles. She is with Olympic Peninsula Extended Needs, or Open Housing. And I say qualified because she's got an excellent resume. It's the insert in your bulletin, and I encourage you all to read it. And Lisa, go right ahead.
Good morning. Can you hear me? Good. I don't think I'll need my 3 minutes because everything that I am about to say has already been said in scripture, song, story, and sermon. But I come to you this morning with great gratitude. So in the Presbyterian Mission Lectionary for Missionaries today, Psalm 50:23, those who bring thanksgiving as their sacrifice honor me. And I have great thanksgiving and gratitude for this congregation and all of your outreaches. I've talked to V, so I know what you folks are doing, and it's a lot. One of the second was Hebrews 11:1, for faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. I come to you this morning in hope, and it's not a passive hope. It's a hope that is helping, H, opportunities, O, possibilities, P, emerge. Helping opportunities and possibilities emerge. I'm familiar with this spot in a congregation, but usually I'm speaking about international ministries. But this is a ministry that comes from home. Imagine, just close your eyes for a moment. Imagine what your life was like when you were in your late teens or early 20s. Maybe you were living with mom and dad. Maybe you'd been living in dorms. And what you wanted more than anything else was your own place. Independence. The ability to thrive without mom and dad. Then imagine what it's like for 99% of adults experiencing intellectual or developmental disabilities on the peninsula. 95 to 99% are living at home. And you know, it's not only those adults who deserve the opportunity to thrive, to live in community, to learn how to relate to others outside of mom and dad's gaze. It's the parents who are ready to live their fullest life in retirement. Perhaps they're less able to do what they can do. So it serves the entire family to have housing at a very low cost, where people can live in community, not only with other IDD people, but with people of all abilities. So shared housing is the model that we hope to develop further beyond the two homes that have been going since 2018 in Sequim, one in Sequim and one in Port Angeles. This is a moment of turning. It takes a lot of faith and a lot of hope and a lot of belief that there will be housing places for all of us so that we can thrive to the fullest extent that we are able. So I put this ministry on your hearts, and I'm going to be here and at the fair. If you want to volunteer at our booth at the fair, you're welcome. And I'm willing to talk anytime about the needs in this area. Thank you for giving me your moments for mission.
As we enter into our call for offering, please remember that the offering trays are in the fellowship hall that for your use as you depart from our service today. You may also send your offerings to the church office or do so online at fpcpa.org. Each of us is a fragile miracle, evidence of God's creative hands and amazing grace. By our very existence, we are proof of God's love, and so we, who are the gifts of creation, now give gifts to our Creator. Gifts brought in love. Will you please rise for the doxology? Let's pray. Blessed are you, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be our God, forever and ever. Amen.
It is God's good pleasure to give us the kingdom. What better symbol is there than to come to the Lord's table and to know that we have a place at the table? Those who profess Christ as Lord and Savior are welcome at this table of the Lord. And I pray that as we are in preparation ourselves, that we are sensing that invitation to come and experience God's goodness and the joy of the kingdom. As we are preparing, those at home, you might have your own communion elements. And as I mentioned, we're extending the table here to include you. For people right here, I want to let you know that when in a moment we come forward to receive communion, I'd like you to just come down the center aisle. And if you would just kind of return and go around on the outside, that would be great. We'll be on the lookout if you'd like us to bring communion to you after we've served everyone else. But also, if you would like individual communion, that's available in the narthex there. There are some boxes. So if you'd rather have communion just seated where you are, just kind of go against the flow and work your way on back, and you can get your own little communion box. Please join me in the great Thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right, O God, that we should give our thanks and praise to you for your great goodness that we see and experience here at the table of our Lord. For Jesus offered his life for his disciples and for us, that we would experience life. And in the coming of the Spirit, that your Spirit would bring us into Christ's presence to celebrate a foretaste of the feast which is to come, to celebrate with the saints who have gone before us in heaven, to taste and know that you are good, and also to be inspired and empowered that going forth from this table, we would do so united as your body, ready to go and fulfill your calling for us, trusting that you have given us what we need for the day and what we need to serve. And so, God, we pray your blessing upon all those who would gather at this table here in this room and those who are at home and far away, wherever they might be. And we remember, oh God, that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, how he took the bread and he blessed it as we've done. He broke it and he offered it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same manner, also after supper, Jesus took the cup and he poured it out for his disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. As often as you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Indeed, as often as we eat this bread and we take this cup, friends, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. And know that these are the gifts of God for us, the people of God. So as I mentioned, in a moment, as you are ready, please come forward and Bruce and I will serve you. We have we'll break off a piece of bread for you. You can take a cup from the tray. There's gluten-free available also. Becca, can you get grab the ones that are in the, oh, you've got yours already? Okay, thanks. Yeah, we're good. Thank you, Jim. I just want to make sure you've got the one that's like everything free, right? So, but we have gluten-free that's available here in the trays. And, let's come to the Lord's table. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this precious gift that we have received, a sign and seal of your grace and your love. And may it be through us a sign for all to see your love, your sacrifice, embodied in us in our service. We pray that the meal that we share here would indeed be a blessing to a broken world, that it would serve to bring peace and reconciliation among people, that it would be a healing power and presence through us. We pray for those who are suffering from violence and war. We pray for the people of Ukraine, and we pray for peace. We lift to you, Jordan, our releasing friend, as our one parish, one prisoner team begins to form relationship with her to prepare for her homecoming in February. We pray for healing for my friend John, who's undergoing a heart procedure on Wednesday in anticipation of some stents being placed. We pray that you would give him peace and comfort as he prepares, and grant that the procedure go well and he'd have full recovery. We pray for Katie, Peg Labiak's neighbor, single mom diagnosed with breast cancer. We ask God that you would give her peace and comfort and provide for her needs, those of her family. For Lila Reyes and her hyperthyroid condition, we pray that the meds that she is receiving will do the trick and that she can avoid surgery. We continue to pray for Tina Geiser and ask that you would grant full healing and recovery from recent kidney infection. And we give you thanks, O God, for the summer that has finally come, the joy of the sunshine, for the long days, and the opportunities that we have to share them out in nature and with one another. And God, we thank you, our family does, for our cat Sally that has gone on to you. Grateful for what pets bring to us and what she shared with us over 15 years. We rejoice, O God, in your great goodness. And we offer this prayer, the one that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Friends, go out into the world in peace and the knowledge of God's goodness. May you experience the fullness of the joy of the kingdom in your service. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.